That's one of the ways they write eternity, right? As long as energy exists within your DNA and the light of Ra shines, you shall exist. Mm. This is why they don't want you to know your language.
Come on and break it down.
Okay? They also make forever and eternity like this. The cobra symbolizing your spinal, your kundalini. As long as there's energy in your mind, you should be able to nourish yourself on the land. As long as the land exists, you will have nourishment, you will have energy, then you shall exist. You see how important this language is. So it speaks to us. It talks about who we are and how we are to flourish off of Ra and the land. Okay, so you need to understand. There's three major domains on this planet. Each planet differs within the solar system. You have the mineral domain, which is based upon carbon, which is black. You have the plant domain, which is based on chlorophyll, which is green. And then you have the animal domain, which is based on melanin, which is black. So only black and green are sources of life. That's why Asar, we picked it green and called the great black. Chlorophyll is to plants as melanin is to human beings, as carbon is to the land. All right, so hopefully that will resonate on you.
All right. Deal, Infidies.
Okay, so again, this importance of dumping into the Madhu Netra. And you notice when we wrote the family, the black family, we have the child, the woman, and the man. Not two brothers, but not two sisters up there. Okay, that's representing eternity. Okay, all right, so we're jumping in here. All right, so is everybody comfortable with what I got up there? You understand what's going on? You understand why it's so important for us to understand the Madhu Netra? Now, ancient Kemet, most of us are mesmerized by the pictures, the gold, the jewelry, and all those things. But what's really so dynamic about Kemet is the mathematics. It's their ability to understand so above, so below. Even a town, these districts in ancient Kemet were written like everybody got this down. You got African. You understand that you've been on your head your whole life.
You can move it forward.
Okay, I can move it forward?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
There you go.
They're moving to the modern era. Okay, all right. I wanted people to know that, for example, this word, pet, means heaven. Heaven. This is like the skyline of the earth. And the creator rests and is nourished through the cosmos. Heaven. Sky. The districts in ancient Kemet, there were 42, were called Sapet. This is Pet, and this is Sapet. Or if in the plural, Sapetu or Saput. This means to cause to be like heaven. Mm. So every district was trying to imitate a cosmological phenomenon that existed in the sky, which means that you already, before you had Kemet, before you broke the 42 districts down, you already had to plot the sky. You already understood the zoomorphic energy in the sky representing certain energies. So, in ancient Kemet, every sapet to cause like had to have a zoomorphic image in the sky. Like your school had to have a mascot. Every state has to have a flag. So, every sapet had a flag, had a zoomorphic energy. It had a bird, a stone, a crystal, a oil. And so today, each state in the United States, because you had 53 of the 56 people who signed the Declaration of Independence were all Freemasons, they were studying this. So every state got a flag, they got a flower, got a bird. They didn't get that from Europe. That's all African. So I need you to clearly understand that, where that phenomena comes from. we took this really serious. As we plotted the heavens, we took that information and duplicated it on Earth. All right? So, Madhu Lecture. Why is this so divine? Why is it should be our classical angle? It's divine words of the Creator. Madhu represent words, but what kind of words? This is a walking stick of an elder. So it's just not any words, it's wise words of an elder. A wise words of an elder who's connected to divinity. And so that was the spoken language and the written language. I'm going to pass this around. This is so-called how they were supposed to break the code of how to read the Madhu Lecture. This is called the Rosetta Stone. This is a duplicate of the Rosetta Stone. I know we talked about it, but like Brother Kaba, I'm a teacher. I'm a touchy-feely guy. You know, I want you to touch it, feel it. You just don't sit on it. Okay, pass that around. So you can see the three different types of languages to help. What they didn't tell you is that Rosetta, that Champollion, best friend, had taught him Coptic. And Coptic is the last version of the Madhu Lecture. They didn't tell you that. My sister had a question over there. What? Well, it's divine words, but I was letting you know that the words represent words of an elder, so it's divine words of our elders expressed through the Creator. Mostly, we're going to have a question and answer period, you know, so let me go. So, Lecture. Now, some of our brothers who don't speak the language are regurgitating what the Europeans say, so they break this down and they just use NTR, and they say Lecture. But I want you to know, in the old period, the first golden age, and in the second golden age, they used the word Lecture, and they spelt it like this. So that's why we have to know the glyphs. This word is TCH. So this is N. TCH. R. The Lecture. It's where the word nature comes from. If you put your vowels in, you get the word nature. What does nature mean to you? Huh? Come on, give me some definitions of nature.
Life.
Life. Air.
Energy.
Energy. Okay, so that's the way we look at the Creator. It was divine, a divine nature. That's everything. Don't substitute this word for God. All of the Egyptologists and even our own African scholars just substitute nature for God. God is a Gothic word and it doesn't mean this. Because when I say the nature, I'm talking about the heartbeat, the beat in between the heart, water, air, the cosmos, that which cannot be seen, that which is still coming into being. My shoes. The nature is all that exists. There's nothing outside of the nature. I don't think when you're in church, I don't think they kind of say God is like that. You know, God ain't no bug. You know, they're not thinking that, but you know, no, we're thinking that, oh no, that bug, God is expressed in that bug. And therefore, I don't need to be smashing. Just pick it up and put it outside. It was probably there before you were. Okay, all right. Nature, everything is divine. And so therefore, we look at nature differently. Everybody who came to ancient Kush or Kemet in Africa said, these are the most divine spiritual people we have ever seen. In fact, they're fanatical about it. We were only fanatical about it because they were absent of it. What's being fanatical about giving homage and life to all living beings? How many of y'all in your biology class or something had organic and inorganic? Like some things had life and some things didn't. That don't even make no sense. Everything has life. Energy cannot be destroyed, only transformed from one state to another. Only the Creator creates. All we do is reorganize the nature's creation.
Break it down.
Do y'all understand that?
Yes.
Don't let them bamboozle you there. You know, in a class called chemistry. Chem, the black science.
That's right.
How many people understood that when they got in their chemistry class that you were studying the black science? Nobody. Okay, that means you've been bamboozled. Okay. All right. So, are we clear on this word, this language, Madhu Lecture, what it means, and why we need to understand the language, because it went from there to Lecture. See, The Egyptologists will put a line under the T, and that means that's TCH, right? Tetch. But after a while, the line just vanished, and people just said netter, and now people, and then people add an S on here talking about the netters. I don't know what they're talking about, okay? When you want to make it plural, it becomes the netteru. Now, I need to stay here because here we go. The gods and goddesses of Egypt.
Go on and do your work.
No, brothers and sisters. No gods and goddesses of Egypt. The divine principles and laws of ancient Kemet. Each one of y'all, see, once you know, you got a responsibility. Before y'all were ignorant. Everybody take a sniff. Go in. Once you know, you have a responsibility.
Can y'all continue passing it down? Don't take
it. Somebody can't get the sniff. They're missing the oil. Okay.
No, right. Missing the Rosetta Stone.
Okay, the Rosetta Stone. So let me just take a minute now and go through the netteru since we are right there. The divine principles and laws. And people, everybody in this room, I don't care if you're a Christian, Muslim, Buddhist, atheist, you haven't figured it out yet. The divine principles and laws don't care. Everybody in here is familiar with gravity?
Oh, yeah.
Do you think gravity cares, you like it or not?
No.
Do you think gravity cares who you are, whether it's going to respond to you? No, gravity gets us all. It's a principle. It's a law. Mm-hmm. It's set up by the divine creator. And it acts on all of us unless you become creator-like. And only when you become creator-like can you mind melt with that energy and alter its state. That's what alchemy and stuff is all about. Transferring the energy and the vibration, because everything in the universe is energy. So that means the only way you can divide a law or a principle is you become the law or principle and you redefine it within your own paradigm. Mm-hmm. Some of y'all will get that in the morning. Okay, now. Haru Imaketi. How many of y'all want to call this something else? Come on, level with me. You want to call it the what?
Sphinx.
Sphinx, y'all. Come on out with it. The Sphinx, a mythological creature that comes from Europe that has wings that will kill you if you don't know the riddle. Has nothing to do with Haru Imaketi. To master your animal domain, which is like the lion, mm-hmm. to rise to your highest spiritual nature, which is the high priest. Okay. So now, if your son says, I want to be a Sphinx, or if he said, I want to be Haru Imaketi. Which one would you send, Jim? Right, he says, Dad or Mom, I want to protect our family and our culture from sunrise to sunset. And I want to be like Haru, the champion of the people. You see, that's why we can't let other people define our stuff. Haru Imaketi. Let me hear y'all say it. Haru Imaketi. All right, I can feel the vibration go up. All right. Washington, D.C., how many people been there? You seen the Washington Monument? Some of y'all think it came from Washington. No? This is imitation. This is the Tekken. How many people saw our video, the Tekken? All right, I'd like to see that after all this. Yeah, give yourself something. Support yourself. Okay. The Tekken. It's our spiritual energy representing the masculine phallic symbol, which has to interconnect with the female symbol in order to create life. But it's symbolic of our resurrection, our rebirth, our renewal. There were usually two of these set on both sides of all the temples in Kemet to represent the father and the son, Asar and Aset. The ruling king was Haru. When he died, he became Asar to resurrect, to be reborn, to live over and over and over again. And we bear witness because we are their children. And they live through us. Let me make this statement, y'all. You are the ancestors. The ancestors is not somebody you just pour libation to. The ancestors is not somebody you go visit in a cemetery. Their DNA is passed through your veins. You are a culmination of all these people I was talking about going back tens of thousands of hundreds of years. They exist through you.
Yes.
So when you say their names, it resonates in your veins.
Oh, yes.
It gives you a responsibility. And we have four ways we ancestor that energy. Number one, we speak their names. El Haj Malik, El Shabazz, Omawali. When you speak their name, Marcus, Messiah God. When you speak their names, they resonate within you. Okay? That gives you your energy, your responsibility. When you say Harriet Tubman, you're leading the Underground Railroad. Yeah. Even if it's just your neighborhood, help somebody. Yeah. What? Harriet said she could have helped hundreds of thousands more if we only knew we were slaves. Mm. If you only knew you was upside down, you'd be able to get yourself straight. Mm. So it's your job to help, to be like Harriet Tubman. So when you mention these names, so that's the first way. You speak their name. Number two, you deify their complete works. These are their complete works. They laid down the principles, the laws of the universe. They charted the stars. They set up the zodiac, the zoomorphic energy of the sky that exists within us. The combination of all the animals in the world exists within you. You ever seen a fetus going through its various stages? It goes through the water stage, the amphibian stage, to the mammal stage. You are a combination of all the animals that exist on Earth. They exist within you, but you're taking it to a higher conscious because you can act like the creator. You can take the thought and create it to anything you want. So we are nature-like. So when I open up and say we are divine spiritual beings, having a divine human experience, look at yourself as a divine being. How many people have seen this? You bump into something and go, oh, I'm so clumsy. You know, no, that's called negative self-talk. That permeates in your water. Your body is 75% water. Water holds more memory than any molecule on the planet Earth. So when you speak to your water reflects that energy back. So that's why positive affirmation is so powerful, because when you speak to yourself, that resonates in your water, and your water said, yeah, yeah. So you don't get in the mirror talking about, oh, this is a bad hair day. I can't get it together. No. Then you think your hair bad? It's really going to get funky. Okay? No. Speak what you want. Don't talk about how broke you are. Talk about how your funds is getting ready to come in.
That's right.
They're a little low now. You got that disease called my funds is low. Okay? But you're getting ready. It's coming. It's flowing. Can you feel it, brother?
It's coming in.
All right. That's what I'm talking about. Okay? It's coming. Speak what you want. That's why in all the sacred books it says, in the beginning was the what?
Word.
And the word was what?
With God.
With God. And the word was
God.
Where do you think they got that from? Amen. 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 Okay, all right. Let me go here. Sabek. They don't usually tell you about this.
Come on and break them down.
Sabek is the Kemetic word for time. The Sabek has 60 teeth, 60 seconds in a minute. 60 vertebrae going down his back. 60 minutes in an hour. This goes on. Sabek is amphibious, but yet it's mammal. It lays eggs like a bird, but yet it's a mammal. It has to lay its eggs outside of the water. And so when the Nile was getting ready to overflow, Sabek knew just how high the Nile would flow, plant his eggs at that level, and the people knew where to start moving their things to. Because that's how in tune Sabek was with the flow of the Nile and the energy that exists within the universe. We have that ability, we just kind of lost ours, okay? But Sabek, symbolic of time. Sabek is another energy of Setesh, okay? Sabek, the crocodile, will only bother you if you are confused and don't know what you're doing. When the Hopi River was low, the Sabek would come on land looking for some food. Now, if the Hopi River is low, you know you ain't supposed to be hanging down there, taking a nap on the beach. Then you was going to be a snack, okay? And then you want to be mad at Sabek. He's doing what he was doing. You are not doing what you're supposed to be doing. Controller of time. You can't control time. Control your energy within time, because time is only a concept of consciousness. Our ancestors were able to travel through time because they bent it based upon their consciousness.
That's right.
So you didn't take you 1,000 years to go to another planet. You can get there like that. Mm-hmm. They talk about we come from Spadet. If you were on a spaceship like we have today, it would be 1,000 years to get there. They got there like that because they bent time, because time is only relevant to your level of consciousness. This happens to be Usir Ma'at Ra, Setepin Ra, the person they call Ramses II. He's wearing a compressed crown, the blue crown. if you see little curls, little knots up on top of here, it represents a hairstyle. In my book, I showed about it. The Watusi, the Zulu, all of them wore this hairstyle during the second golden age when it came to an end and we got invaded by the Hyksos, the Asiatic foreigners who ruled Kemet for maybe 100+ years. When they were kicked out, the brothers from the south, up south, where's my map?
You erased it.
No. Oh, I sure did. That's all right. I got a backup. The brothers from, you see, we have to manufacture our old stuff. That just goes in here. I don't depend upon the Wazugu information. We got our own stuff because we are the creators of all this stuff. We have to go back and producing our own books, producing our own tapes, producing our own works, producing our own houses. Most of our houses are backwards and set up for Wazungu. We need to change it. Why do you want energy from Con Ed when you got Ra, the sun? Let me say that again. Why do you plug into Con Ed when you got Ra, the sun? You see how we're depending upon our former enslavers? We need to come together. And we need to make it happen. Ra's still waiting on us. All right, now. So, our brothers who came from up south wore this hairstyle as they kicked the enemy, the Hyksos, butt all the way back into Asia. The ancient Kemet-Te'u was so thankful and so appreciative of this that they developed a crown, a war crown, it's called the war crown, that whenever they went into battle, and it didn't have to be physical battle, it could be a spiritual battle. Whenever they were having large meetings to organize the community, the Nusuk put this crown on. So this is from the third golden age on. That's the so-called 18th dynasty. So from that dynasty on is the only time you see this crown. So if you see somebody with this crown, they try to say that was the old period or the first. Wrong, okay? You know your story. Third golden age on, 18th dynasty on, okay? Aset. I have to put Aset with Asar. We have Sar the Great Black. Aset, let me write her name down so that y'all see this connection between the two. This is the right angle that the Masons and everybody get all excited about. Okay. You stand on your square, brother, you know, okay. But in here, there would be the Simatawi, and they would have a lotus plant and a papyrus plant tied with a knot showing the unification of upper and lower Kemet, okay? And it's on the square. This is the throne. This is how you write Aset's name, Aset. She is the throne maker. No ruler in Kemet can sit on the throne until they come through her, through the woman. And so, brothers, when you think you rule in the house, you rule through your woman. Okay? She is the throne. When they want to write Asar's name, he got the throne there, right? But his name, Wasar or Asar, is like that because he is the eye behind the throne. Also is an action verb that means to make, to do, to bring things, to make things happen. And so he takes the energy from the feminine energy and makes it happen. He is the eye that protects the throne. That's why he has the cobra and the uraeus on top of his head. That represents upper and lower Kemet, the two ladies. The two women, that's called Nebti. So you have Nebti. You have on this side, you have the vulture. And on this side, you have the cobra. Wajet and Nekabet, all right? And so when the king has this two symbols on his crown, that represents that he is a protector of the two energies. And you'll see this on all of the Nesut. Usually the woman only has the cobra on her head, but everybody is seeing this. You've seen the bust. On my table, I got a bust of, you see the cobra. That represents the Nebti, the two ladies, women. In ancient Kemet, they constantly showed you just how important you are, how powerful you were, that we exist through you. Our very nature is to protect you and they keep you because you are a divine essence of all life on this planet. So brothers, can y'all give these sisters a hand right now? Show them an appreciation for them. Stand up and give them a standing ovation. Stand up, brothers. You are the reason why we do what we do. We ain't doing this for the other brother, like Alexander and his Greek army. No, you know, Alexander was gay, even though he was undefeated in battle. He would always put, he would divide the lovers up and have them flank from both sides. And so the lovers, and they would put the enemy in between. So the lovers was frightened to get through the enemy to get to their lover on the other side. So they were tenacious warriors. Okay, all right, so we're not going there. All right. So, you understand just feminine nature. So Asar became the I, the maker, the doer, Aset. She is the feminine energy, the mut, the womb. On top of her head, she has the cow, because she was also depicted as the great cow, like at Het Haru. That's what's up here. Het Haru, Aset, Neferhet. Sometimes they would be all intertwined, because they represent the mut, the mother energy. And the mother energy would be depicted by the vulture. Now I know I was teaching them to do nature class, and his sister said, oh, so y'all the great falcon, and we got to be a buzzard. I'm like, sister, no, you went real left. You were real European on me. You got to alter your state of consciousness. You only came like that because you was upside down. What you should have asked me was, well, what does this buzzard this represent? And you'll realize that it's one of the greatest nurturing mothers on the universe.
Right.
It will eat off its own leg, chew it up, and feed it to its children when there's no food.
That's right.
Mm. The female vulture doesn't need a male to get pregnant. It faces the eastern wind, and the wind impregnates. Shu. We call it Shu, the cosmic winds of the universe. Not only that, she has such a powerful stomach acid, she can devour a carcass that has maggots and everything on it that would make any other animal sick. She can digest it and then regurgitate it and feed it to her young, and it would be nurturing food. So what she did, she took all the carcasses and all the things that would cause disease and cleaned it up. And so, come on, brothers and sisters, you know, like, when stuff get real funky, you call the woman up in there. You know, you got the little baby until something happened, then go back to mommy. Right? And she's the one that cleans up the filth, you know, and everything, you know. You throw up, you know, like, oh, I'm out of here, you know. Right? So mut, that's that mothering energy. And we can go on and on and on. So that's why you have to know these things in nature. Because I'm sure, just raise your hand if you had a negative idea of the vulture. Raise your hand. Look at that. That's because you're upside down, on your head, taking your information from your enemy. Mm. Are you starting to see why we need to change our paradigm? 2012 is here. You're going to die with your enemy unless you change. You understand where we're coming from? Yeah. Brother Kaba made it real clear that the Japanese had a chance to change at the end of World War II. Mm. They were the leading industry of solar energy, but they chose nuclear energy instead. Mm. They wanted to follow the Europeans. They wanted to out-European the Europeans. And now they've almost dug their own grave. Okay, y'all? All right, y'all see what I'm talking about? The Chinese people are only able to get themselves together when they chased their enemy out and had a cultural revolution. When they opened up them doors, they knew who they were.
Say it again, I don't think that
works. Our cultural revolution, Malcolm made it clean. Made it real clear. Okay, he showed a picture of a 10-year-old girl blowing her father's brains out because he was an Uncle Tom Chinaman.
That's right.
When that girl grew up to be a full-grown woman, there were almost no more Toms in China. Mm. Think about it in America. Toms is on the cover of Life magazine. Toms is on the cover of that comic book, Ebony and Jet. Toms is everywhere. You actually look up to Toms. Son, I want you to grow up and be like that Tom. I mean, Dr. So-and-so, okay? Y'all know what I'm talking about? Toms get Nobel Peace Prizes when there's no peace. Now, if the wolf give the sheep a peace prize, and the wolf is fat and the sheep is skinny, there's a problem there.
And we don't see it. And we like, yes, son. Yeah, daughter, you grow up and you might get one of those too.
No, you don't want one of those.
Okay, all right, let's jump back in here. Right. The first family, the first trinity, Asar, Arset, and Haru. I hope I know we got some Jesus folks up in here. They sneaking everywhere. Well, I got some born again Kemetau people in here. You know, like Ray Higgins, he was, the first time he heard the word Haru in a meeting, he wanted to fight. No, Jesus, they got nothing to do with no Haru. You know, he wanted to beat them. He's supposed to be a Christian minister. He's ready to fight, beat somebody up because they confuse Jesus with Haru. But just give him the tape. Look at this. Read this book. 18 crucified saviors before JC. Mm-hmm. And they all did exactly the same thing that JC did prior to him. So JC just had a map. Right? If you wanted that energy, somebody followed that energy that was already laid out, and all he did was do everything everybody else did. Mm-hmm. Okay. You had the Father, the Son, and Haru. The Son is Haru. The word hero comes from the word Haru, because Haru is just H-R-U. If I put an E there, and the U and the O sound the same, the word hero, which means champion of the people. Haru fights against Isfeth.
Right.
Haru was your consciousness. A lot of the Nesutbiti, the rulers, would have the falcon on the back of their head because it represents higher consciousness. Higher consciousness. Okay? And so that means that you got to be in battle every day. I love this example of ancient Kemet. It's not like you can mess up all week and go to church on Sunday and it's okay. Or do Sabbath on Saturday and you'll be forgiven for your sins. Or just confess to Father. Father, I raped a whole lot of people and done some messed up stuff this week, but I know you're going to forgive me. No. Haru says, you have to be a champion every day. How would you feel? Let's say it's 90 degrees today. That means Rob was really, really cooking, right? Rob was out there, y'all was just, you know, oh, yeah. And then Rob said, well, look, I was so good today, I think I'm just not going to come out for a couple days. What would happen? If Rob act like Negroes, 2012 would have been here yesterday. Okay, all right? So Ra is consistent every single day. The universe is consistent every single day. The cosmos is consistent every single day. Energy is flowing every second of every single day. Negroes take breaks every single day. People, you got to kill the Negro inside of you. You got to resurrect. You got to be reborn. You got to be Haru. I want to hear some born again Haru energy up in here. That's what you need. Every day, and I don't care how bad you were yesterday. I don't care if you gave a smoking lecture, you did a whole bunch of stuff, and so today you're just going to get high and hang out. No! You got to come back today and you got to be on it also. You know? So you will never see Info DC at Smitty's Bar having barbecue and hanging out with the boys, talking stuff. Because then it will contradict everything that we're about. Do y'all understand? You got to be Haru all the time. You got to be a champion of the people. If you tell your children, just do what I say, not what I do, what's going to happen? We already know what's going to happen. What's happening now? Pants down. Right, okay. All right. So, Haru is the champion of the people. He's the champion because he does battle with Isfeth. Isfeth is our energy that wants to pull you out of balance, wants to pull you out of harmony. You say, okay, bean sprouts, chocolate cake. I had bean sprouts yesterday. You lost. Listen, the ancient Kemetau makes it real clear. Everything is either life-giving or life-threatening. If you don't remember anything else, remember that. Life-giving or life-threatening. When you get ready to eat, life-giving, life-threatening. You have a mate. Life-giving, life-threatening. I'm not talking about how hot she is or how tough and buff he is. Life-giving or life-threatening. You're getting ready to go out that evening. Is it a life-giving experience or a life-threatening experience? if you're at Smitty's Bar having barbecue with the boys with a cold one, I think that's a life-threatening situation. Okay?
Frisk you before
so
you go in.
Even if you don't even, if you don't do it, everybody around you was doing, you get caught. Listen, I was one of the priests that they brought in for the vigilance for the World Trade Center, for all those blacks who died in the World Trade Center. But one of the things I made sure, as we talked about their souls being resurrected, in, is that when you eat with swine, you die with swine.
Yes.
If you wallow in the mud, you get dirty. If you're playing in the funk, you got to get funky. Brothers and sisters, you need to get the European mindset out of your consciousness. You need to get them off your back, your clothes. You need to get them out of your diet. You need to get them out of your bed. You need to get them out of your total consciousness so that you can go back to being the creators that you, rise waiting on you, ready to give you all the energy you need. All the energy you need. I tell you, I don't have no bad days. Every day is a great, magnificent day. Because you determine how dynamic you're going to be. You determine how much money you want to make. You determine where you want to go. Oh, yeah. I wanted to go to Kemet. 1981, I went with Dr. Ben. You know, I gave him this thesis, this paper and everything. He said, okay, listen, I'll let you go for half price, but you're going to be my aide. I said, oh, bet. I'm down with that. What you want me to do? That was 1981. I've been to Kemet over 25 times, and I've never paid again. You will. You don't need no money. You need your mind.
Yes, yes.
Some of you think you never left anything in Africa. No, you left your mind there. You need to reconnect. Reconnect. Reconnect to the whole continent. Reconnect. Yes, we are the indigenous people here, but you need to go where they came from here. You need to keep that going. So Haru, the father, the son, the mother, the father, and the son, the Holy Trinity. And so you can see where the Christian, now let me just say this. Aset, other name is Marie, the beloved one. That's why Jesus' mother had to be Mary. Marie means the beloved one. So she had the same mother that Jesus had because he's an imitation of her. At 30, he went to go, well, at 13, he went to do his father's work. Haru went to go train with his uncle, Haru Or, in the temples at 13. At 30, he came back to do battle with Set. Jesus came back to do his teaching at 30. The 12 disciples are the 12 zodiac. It had nothing to do with no people. The book is a book of astrology and astronomy. How many people look at their horoscope every day or every other day? Come on, raise your hand. It's not a horoscope. Horror is the word for Haru. Scope is what you look at, so it's Haru's vision. You're checking out Haru's vision. We created this so that we can see where we were going before we got there. And when you get a view from the height, you get sky view. So your Haru vision, your horoscope, was a vision of your future or where you've been. So that you, if it was good, you can get there again. If it wasn't, you know how not to go there. Okay? And it kind of gave you a peek into where you were headed. It was a, what is that called? What's that system? The PG, that you, your car? They help you get there? What is that?
GPS.
What is it?
Global position.
GPS.
The GPS system. Haru, your consciousness, you got that inside. Your cell phone is imitating what you were able to do by sending energy out there. Okay. So we got the Holy Trinity now. Let me come over here. Set, the daughter of Ra. The daughter of Ra. Sekhmet, I see a couple of Sekhmet people hiding over there. Okay, all right. When things were going wrong and people got confused, Ra sent his daughter down to straighten stuff up. So Sekhmet went down, and Sekhmet's job was only to mess with folks who weren't together. But Sekhmet found so many people that weren't together, she started devouring everybody. So the Netcheroo came up and said, Rob, you got to do something about Sekhmet. She just doing everybody in. She just fell in love with blood. She just drinking blood. She just killing everybody. None of the other Netcheroo said, oh no, I ain't messing with that sister. And y'all know, brothers, I don't care how bad a brother is. You ain't seen a real fight. You see some sisters fight.
Hello.
Brothers be just trying to outdo each other. You know, we be trying to get off pretty.
knock them out, say, yeah. You know, I'm like, sisters be trying to kill each other. Ah! Ah! Pulling their hair out. Ah! Get that hair holding back. Ah! Kill them! I ain't never seen a brother's fight like that. So, Sekhmet was doing everybody in. So none of the other Netarun said, no, I ain't touching that. Bro, you gotta do, you send Jehuti down there. So Jehuti, articulate mind, thought, articulate writing, articulate speech, articulate action. So Jehuti came and obsessed the situation. He said, okay, she just fell in love with blood. So I'm just gonna use some black magic on her. Jehuti turned the Nile Hopi River red and told Sekhmet, you don't have to kill nobody else. Just go to the Nile and have a drink. Sekhmet saw all the blood, oh wow, just dove in the, but it was wine. She got all drunk. And when she got almost ready to pass out, Jehuti just put a spell on her and said, when you awaken, you will be Baset.
Wow.
You will no longer be a ferocious lioness. You will be a gentle, beautiful, purring black girl. And you will adorn people, and you will dance and make music, and you will just be loved. And so today, sisters, if you get a little setetious, segmented, get some red wine, call it a day, put on something black, and just get sexy for your man. Okay, and Jehuti, again, represent articulate thought. Jehuti is not some god outside. Remember, Jehuti exists inside of your mind. Everybody has Jehuti in there. When you're using reasoning, when you're using consciousness, that's your Jehuti thought. Don't give up your, the word thought comes from thought. Jehuti, to think. Some of us are not doing that. Okay, so when you're thinking, that's you're doing your Jehuti. Jehuti is the tongue of Ptah, the creative spark of the universe, the creative energy, the architect of the universe, the engineer of life. Jehuti is his tongue. Ra, the creative energy that exists and permeates all things on this planet. Jehuti is his voice. Amun, the unseen energy that permeates every cell and every entity of life throughout the cosmos, is the mind. Jehuti is his mind. So Jehuti, that means that all that is exists within you. And that's why to educate really means to bring out. The Western world, they stuffing stuff in, got you memorizing for tests. No, it's to bring out. I'm not telling you anything that you don't already know. The reason why you're going like, yeah, is because you're resonating on that. That was inside of you. And all I did was bring it to the surface. That's Jehuti. And so he is in there. So y'all got to use your Jehuti. Don't be afraid to put these on your altar and in your house. You ain't bringing some gods and stuff in there. You're bringing divine principles that's going to help you on your mission. And each of these principles can resonate with a Haru vision. They can resonate on your organs that plays the music for your temple. They can resonate on you getting your program together. Maybe you need a little Sekhmet in your life. Maybe you've been procrastinating, so you need Jehuti on your altar looking you in your face every day so you can do what you're supposed to be doing.
Okay.
And if they don't get it, you get it for them and put the Jehuti out there. Anpu. A lot of us wear black at funerals. No, you should probably be wearing white to reflect, to come back so that you can get the energy. The European saw that Anpu was black and all his priests wore the black as they were preparing the body. So, because they didn't bury their dead. You understand that, right?
Yeah.
The ancient Asiatics and the ancient Europeans didn't bury their dead. When you're in a cave, ain't no place to bury. When Uncle Raheem died, you just put him over on the side.
Yay.
When you run out of bowls, you just get his head and kind of wash it out. And you're drinking out of his skull.
Man.
Right, you know, okay. And that's why they got all these horror pictures, the night of the living dead and all that. Because they were living with the dead people. They were in the cave with them.
Look, if you're locked in an ice glacier that's a mile high, and you can't get out, only certain people can. That means that some people never saw the sun in their whole lifetime. So you're in a cave, you never saw the sun. Uncle Raheem died, you just put him over on the side. He rigor mortis set up, he stand up, come out of here. Okay. So that's in your subconscious. That's in your subconscious mind. So you got people walking around, you know, half eaten up. Come on, Frankenstein, all that. That comes out of the European mind. We created theater, y'all, and we didn't have no horror. That's from the Greek ethic. They created horror. They got the fan face and the sad one and the happy face. You know, no, we just had some happy faces. You know, we had some mystery and stuff like that. But you know, we were trying to make it real. But the horror stuff, no, we didn't. No, that wasn't our cup of tea. Okay, all right. So I need you to understand that. So Anpu was just preparer of the body for the next journey. He has a whole bunch of different names, you know? The one who was the head of the mountain. The one who was leader of the way. The guardian. The transformer. You know, all those different names. Each of the natural rule has many different nicknames. And in my book, Spiritual Warriors and Healers, I break down all the natural rule. I give you the various different names and their energy. You know, and I break down little concepts. Like, for example, when we say that every living king was Shamsu Haru. Mm-hmm. Now you say, come on, bro. The king is a bird. A pigeon. What's up with that? There's a person who doesn't understand nature. I said, no, man. The hawk, the falcon, and the eagle, they're in the same fin. They fly higher than any bird. They got an extra layer of skin that goes over their eye, and they can see directly in the sun. No other creature can do that. They have no rivalry in the sky. Their vision is so keen, they can spot a mouse under a leaf from a mile, hovering a mile in the sky. And they're 99% accurate. Air pilots are imitating falcons. They can calculate the speed and the bend of light. A fish is going this way. He's going this way, 70 miles an hour. Dives down, turns in under the water, and comes up 99% of the time with the fish. People, they're still trying to calculate that. And so now, if you understand this power that the falcon, the eagle has, he has no rivalry in the sky. He perches and has his nest on the highest mountain or the highest tree. Now, so if you understand that, because you live in the country and you understand that, and a brother came up to you and said, I'm a mighty falcon. You'd be like, yeah, you got it. Especially if you've been acting like a chicken. That chicken for breakfast, you know, yeah, you got this, you know. You ain't trying to get away because there ain't no place to go. Ain't no place to hide. So that's the way the rulers in ancient Kemet, they were Shamsu Haru. They were mighty falcons. So you have to understand nature. But watch this, and I teach that everything in nature has at least three levels. You see, this is where the magic is. Watch this. Come on, magical Kemet. This is Kepler. Now, I know I'm teaching this in class, and sister, oh, no, you're going to study bugs now. No, sister, rise up, rise up. Alternate. You upside down, turn around. Kepler, a dung beetle. So we understand the first level is the concrete, the physical, what it is. What does the dung beetle do? The dung beetle recycles the filth. In the Serengeti Plains in Tanzania, hundreds of elephants, giraffes, zebras, water buffalo, all out grazing. So if you're grazing, if something goes in, it has to what? Come out. So you know it has the potentiality to get very funky. Y'all bear with it? Can I get an amen on that? Amen for the funk. Okay, now. Kepler cleans up all of the funk. An elephant turd is like this big. When it comes down, within 2 hours, you can't find it. Thousands, hundreds of thousands of these dung beetles verge on it. They dig a hole in the ground. That's called irrigation. Then they roll the dung into a perfect sphere. No other creature on the planet can do that. They lay their eggs inside of it and then bury the inside of the ground. So when they put the dung
in the ground. That's called what? Fertilization. Irrigation, fertilization. So you see why the Serengeti, the largest grassland in the world is the Serengeti Plains in Tanzania. There are more animals there per square mile than any place else on the planet Earth. The home of Kevin. In the south. Up south. Y'all understand? Y'all with me? Take another sniff, y'all. We going in. Okay, that's the physical level. That's the physical level. So, we understand that it recycles. It takes filth and cleans it up. In the morning, when you step out in the Tanzania plain and take fresh air. No dung. Right now, they got to import dung beetles to Texas because all the cows is pooping all over every place. The underground water is all polluted and it's messing up the whole water shift, the whole watershed and everything like that because they messed up the ecology because they don't know nothing about nature. They killed all of the natural pesticides and insects with their pesticides and fertilizers. Okay. So now we have a concrete level. Number two is what does it do? It recycles. It comes into being. And every day. Because if they took a day off of not collecting the poop, y'all understand what would happen, right? 1,000 zebra, 1,000 wildebeest, 1,000 and some elephants. All you need is a day off. Y'all got the picture? Everybody got, you got the picture. See, visualization is happening here. You got the picture. So he's coming into being and he's coming forth every day. Mm-hmm. Y'all remember what it was like in New York when the garbage people took went on strike, right? It got real funky, literally, in New York, right? Okay, so that's the way nature would be. So nature doesn't take no days off. Only fools and Negroes. Okay, so two, coming into being, coming forth. That's the second level. The third level is the spiritual level. Now you get the Egyptology books on hieroglyphics, and they don't even deal with this because they don't understand that. Their pineal gland is like a raisin. It's all dried up. Your pineal gland is like a grape. It's all juicy and stuff, a little big black grape, and you're seeing visions and colors on many dimensions, and they don't even know what you're talking about. You be like, what you listening to? They think you got some earplugs in. You ain't got no earplugs in. You just vibing, you know. Okay? Because you are everywhere and nowhere at the same time. They can't even understand that. They can't even fathom that. They outside of that. The average European Caucasian, by the time they're 13 going through puberty, their pineal gland is calcified. Go check me out. So the spiritual level is that Kepra means that spiritually I'm coming into evolving into my mission. And so when Kepra is placed, like, watch here. When a person dies, they put a big Kepra and they put gold around. This is what the nobility. Yeah, if you were a poor farmer, you didn't get the gold. But you could still get the Kepler. Okay? Gold intensifies. If we deal with metals, copper conducts electricity, silver metabolizes and keeps things in harmony, vibrating on the pitch it's supposed to be. And gold intensifies. So that's why the thugs is all gold down, because it intensifies your thugism. So you ain't a real thug. You got 20 pieces of gold around your neck. You a real thug now. Okay, because it's going to intensify what you're doing. Okay, they don't want no silver. They don't want to be metabolized. They don't want to be harmonizing and stuff like that. You know, and they definitely ain't putting no copper on, you know. But that's what you need to be into. You have to understand. Gold intensifies. Silver metabolizes and keep harmonic energy, like my aunt. And then copper boosts your electric charge, your electrical charge. Okay, if you add magnetic to it and iron, then that also helps your flow of energy. You just gotta watch out, make sure you got a pacemaker on that menu. Okay. Alright. So, three levels. The concrete, the abstract, but what it does, and then the spiritual level. So every word in the Madhu Netra is done like that. To come forth don't mean just to come towards me. To come forth means to come with the flow of energy. Flow the way the universe is flowing. That doesn't mean that. Look, watch this here. And cheer. Cheer is cheer. I don't care if you got 3 PhDs. It don't get no deeper than that. Y'all understand that? An ancient Kemet, the Nastu, got as deep as you are. Not only was it a sacred divine stool that everyone needs to sit, but the king rules through the stool. It's like the Ashanti people, it's who sits on the throne. Well, the Nasut will say, I am the Nasut of the Nastu. I am ruler of the sacred stools. Come on. If somebody told you they was the king of the chair, you'd be trying to get away from them. Yeah, okay. You got that. Because a chair is a chair in English. This language is limited. An ancient Kemet that had many divine levels to it. So everything was on at least 3 levels. There would be more levels, but that you only learn that through initiation. Okay? So that's what I'm... And this is how I got into crystallology here, y'all. The crystals we get outside. If you look at here, look. Lapis lazuli. Carnelian. Turquoise. The gold, the silver. Blue lace agate, emerald, all of these are the stones, and they are consistent with representing the energies in your body. Now, let's just come into Kemet. All this, I was just setting up Kemet. Now I just want to talk about what is it in ancient Kemet. First of all, y'all been told the wrong thing again. Every time y'all talk about kings and queens, let me say this. In Kemet, in the Hopi Valley, we had no kings and queens. That's a concept outside of our paradigm. The ruler in ancient Kemet was called this energy at the top. The Nasut. And then when he ruled both lands, he was called the Nasut Biti. Not Pharaoh. Pharaoh is some Greek word. It comes from the word Per-ah. Brother Kaba broke down how the word Egypt was a misnomer of Hekabata. Well, Pharaoh comes from the word Per-ah, the great house. You don't call him a ruler. Obama is the president of the United States. When he comes in, you don't go, oh, they go to the White House. No, you say that's President Barack Obama. Okay? You don't call him the White House. No one called the ruler in ancient Kemet the Per-Ankh, the Great House. You call them by their name. They were the Nasut Biti. Every ruler had at least 5 names. He had a birthing name. He had a Haru name. He had a golden Haru name. Then he had a Nasut Biti name, and then he had a Sa Ra name. Sa Ra. So these two names will be put inside of a shin. A shin is an elliptical orbit that shows that the ruler ruled every place that the sun shone. That the sun was shining and it rose and set. How many people call this a cartouche? That's French. That means a cartridge, a bullet. Because that's what it looked like when the French sword. Don't call those sacred symbols a cartouche, a French name. It's a shin. S-H-N. Or if you can put a little E in there if you can't pronounce it. A shin. So, the Sa-Ra and the Nasut Biti will be placed inside of a shin. The Sa-Ra is the son of the sun. Everybody who went to the temples in ancient Kemet, regarded, that's why all the early Hebrews, the early Christians, they got that halo around it. That meant they went to the temples in ancient Kemet. It had nothing to do with no theological stuff. No, it meant that they studied in Kemet at the sacred temples, and they were sons and daughters of the sun. Take that mysticism out of it. Okay, sons and daughters of the sun. So The ruler recognized that one of his names is he was the son of the sun. His other name is Nasut Biti. Remember we talked about the cobra and the vulture, Nekabet and Wajet? Well, Nasut, the south, Biti, the north. The north is where the grapes and the wine and all of that was. That's where the bee was. The suit is the south. Remember we talked about when I drew the plant, this was a symbol for south. The suit plant. Sometimes they can leave this off and they just call them the Nasut. N-S-W-T. The Nasut. It was, so that meant, but you European Egyptologists don't want you to know that because the Nasut means the ruler, the ruling energy from the south where the sledge and the suit plant grows. So if the south is in the interior of Africa, the rule of Kemet is saying he is the ruler from the south where the divine energy of nourishment comes from, then you know the Nasut can't be no white people coming out of the interior of Africa. And they got white pharaohs. They every time they make a picture, they got some white pharaoh sitting up there, somebody with no melanin. That couldn't happen if, but if he's called the pharaoh, that could be anybody. But if you say, I'm the Nasut, I'm the divine energy from the south where the nurture of creativity and rulership comes from. That's a whole nother picture. So that's why they don't want you to know Nasut Biti. And Biti, we're the first people to take and cultivate honey and use it as a commerce to do to export it all around the world. Okay? And that's from the Biti. And we actually had barges and ships that were only for the bee to develop the honey, and we can control their diet on the ships. And so that if it was supposed to be barley honey, it was only barley. That was supposed to be maple honey, it was only maple. You know, it was like that. So the first cultivation of honey. And we teach in a Kemetic journal where there's 100 remedies that honey is used for. Even right now, most amputees would be saved if they would just wash it and place honey over the wound. Honey acts as an automatic antiseptic and antibiotic, and it will heal where all their medicine cannot heal. So most amputees with gangrene, all you had to do was wash it and put honey on it. And no disease and no gangrene can set in. Okay? But we teach, when you learn that Medu Netcha, 100 ways that honey can be used to help heal and maintain harmony in the body. So if you see the names of the rulers, had power, there was a whole, there were layers, y'all. They went real deep. I'm only giving you the surface here. As you take a Medu Netcha class, we go in much deeper. Okay, so I'm just trying to give you. So the Nasut Biti. And this came about at approximately 4240 when Namas reunited Upper and Lower Kemet. Okay? We encourage you. There's three major, well, myths that you can get into when you're after you learn the Medu Netcha. And first is the Pyramid Text. The Pyramid Text is the oldest spiritual beings works in terms in written form. But it talks about a time that goes to that 7,500 and 10,000 years ago. The Pyramid Text is talking about that time up until the time where we're just beginning to do pyramids. So they had information of astronomy when Kemet first started. So that's why Kemet looked like within 300 years or 200 years, it went from a little simple pottery to the space age, okay? Because they already had libraries with all this information housed in it. So the Pyramid Text talks about astrological space travel and understanding energies from outside of our solar system in the Pyramid Text. So the Pyramid Text is one. Then you want to do the Coffin Text. The Pyramid Text is the first golden age. The second golden age, which they would call the middle period, is the Coffin Text. And that was the information written on all of the coffins and in the walls, the funeral text that was on the walls inside of the sacred burial grounds. Okay? And then the third text is this one, the Per-Imhotep, which they call the Book of the Dead. They call it the Book of the Dead because they found these writings with the dead people. But they didn't understand that people weren't dead, okay? That it was a book of life, a book of coming forth by light. It was a book how to be immortal. It was a book how to overcome Isfed, even in the afterlife. Because remember, if energy cannot be destroyed or created, then your physical body goes back to nature, but your soul and your spirit goes on. And they call the soul Ba and the spirit Ka. Right? Okay. That's why you have something, the Kabbalah, even among the Muslims, okay? The spirit and the soul connected to the Creator, okay? And so those are books you also want in the Fourth Golden Age. You want the Shabaka text, and the Shabaka stone and all that is part of the Shabaka text. So you have the Pyramid text, the Coffin text, the Per Imhuru, and the Shabaka text. And then there's a couple of Sabiat's teachings of Ptahotep and some people like that you want to get into. But you want to read our version. I encourage these books because I don't have to read what they said. I just go in, they wrote it, they blew up the picture so big, you just go in and read the text. Don't go by what the Wazungu said. Remember, he doesn't understand the whole spiritual thing, and everything that we did was spiritual. So they're going to give you, the words might be right, but the meaning totally wrong in the way they translate it. So 90% of the things they have translated have to be redone by us, brothers and sisters. We hold the magic of ancient Kemet. We are magical Kemet. Kemet is waiting for us. All those writings on the wall are still waiting for us to translate it. They're still waiting for us to come into our right consciousness so that we can go back and get the messages they left us. Why, when the Europeans came in, they destroyed everything, but they left the Madu Netra on the wall? Think about it. And get rid of the people. They get rid of all the rituals. Destroyed, made you couldn't do the spiritual system anymore. But they didn't destroy the Madu Netra on the walls.
They couldn't read it.
But they tear up stuff they can't read. That's what they do. They tear stuff up. They masters that tear stuff up. But they didn't touch the Madu Netra. It's still there on all the sacred temples for 4,000 years. You can go to the libraries and the museums, and they still got papyri still preserved. Ancestors knew. And they left these keys for us. Brothers and sisters, you remember all them pictures you saw of how they built the pyramids, carrying these 2.5-ton, 15-ton blocks up a ramp? And pyramids wasn't built like that. All the real initiates know. I can't tell you right now. If I tell you, I have to kill you. Okay, but anyhow, if you come to initiation, come to me, do that class, we show you how that do it. You remember early in the lecture, we talked about that energy principles. You were governed by them. Unless you became the principle, when you became the principle and you were the energy, then only at that point you can alter the energy. Well, blocks were willed and made and put right into place. They can't even find the place where some of the places were quarried because it wasn't. There's something called the funeral text. The funeral text talks about how Imhotep had to go into Kush and to consult Khnum, the great molder, and understand all the minerals and gems so that he can manufacture and build temples that will last forever. Mm. And so what it tells us that Imhotep, who's being classified as the father of modern architecture, the first personal building in blocks, that's not correct. That's the way the Europeans are feeding it to you. But if Imhotep went to consult the libraries that was thousands of years old, who was doing that writing? So he had to go to ancient Kush. But they're trying to tell you that Kush is an offshoot of Kemet. It was a colony of Kemet, and then when Kemet fell, they just kind of imitated with Kemet. Well, nobody else built temples like that but the Kushites. So a lot of people was biting off of ancient Kemet. They weren't able to do what they were doing in Kemet, but the Kushites could. The Kushites were even doing this in the common era. During the time of Christ, so-called Christ, the Kushite civilization was still flourishing. So you need to examine this writing that's on the wall. You need to examine this energy. In those texts, watch this here. In the Sahu, which they call Orion, on Orion's belt, he has a sword. And at the end of the sword is a real bright star. And the ancient connector Ooh in the pyramid text said, we come from there. Some of us come from there, and some of us come from Spadet. So now, only in the 20th century, European astronomers have found out that that's not a star at the end of his sword. It's a nebula. A nebula is the like a incubator, a cluster of energy that creates stars. It's the oven that creates stars, that creates all the elements in the universe. And the and they knew in the pyramid text 6,000 years ago that their solar system comes from there. Do you see how deep this is going to get? And that's just the beginning. So that means the writers of the pyramid text understood that at Orion's, that was a nebula that created the star that our sun comes from. This gets really deep, y'all. It's really important. See, the magic in Kemet is waiting on you. You want to hear about some hocus pocus. Magical Kemet is Jehuti locked in your mind, upside down with a headache trying to get out. Jehuti's tired of speaking English and French and Spanish, German. Jehuti wants you to go. Amin Ra Nasuk Netra Atin Ra Nebenang Te Inu Ank Ujas Neb Neb Atu Amra Amantu Saru. That's what they want to hear. You are divine beings vibrating on a level that they can't even understand. That's magical Kemet. Magical Kemet is when you wake up and go back and claim what is yours. Claim what is yours. The reason why some of the Arabs can destroy some of those heirlooms in ancient Kemet when they were going through the resurrection, because that's not their ancestors. They just got there yesterday. They pimping our stuff. Hosted. Think about it. They come from an Islamic society, and they consider this idols and worshiping and blasphemy. And they got you scared of your own stuff. You'd be like, oh no, you're trying to find your cross. You know, as you, some of you, if you bring something in your house, your parents are like, did I go wrong, baby? When you start tapping back into the real nature, when you tap into the real source, golden Kemet is vibrating in your heart, it's in your blood. Your blood is liquid crystals. Study the crystals. They will tell you, they align yourself with every organ in the body. And don't go for the seven chakra thing. Well, Dr. Leader Africa tells us we got at least 12 major centers. You got hundreds of chakra centers, or we call it Shechem Shin Ra. So you even got to leave their language alone. Sanskrit, we taught them. Come home, y'all. Kemet is waiting for you. The writing on the wall wasn't there for nothing. Those temples are still there. Listen, you go to Jerusalem. And they say, okay, well, this is where we think Christ went, and over here, because it ain't there no more.
That's right.
You go to Assyria, we believe the Tower of Babylon must have been in this hole somewhere around here. You go to Kemet and it's still there.
Yes.
The pyramids are still there.
That's right.
Haru Imaketi is still there. What they're talking about, they, now even the Europeans is messed up with the dating. They tried to say that Ka'ef Ra, the son of Khufu, the builder of the Step Pyramid, made Heru-Im-Akheti in the temple next to him. But then they found an inventory text that said that Khufu, the builder of the Great Pyramid, built a small mortuary temple next to Heru-Im-Akheti in a temple that was already there before the so-called builder of the temple. Now, if this was there before the Great Pyramid, when was it built? Is facing with the on horizon where Leo comes up in horizon. Leo came up in the horizon 10,000 BCE. So this was built 10,000 BCE. But now somebody says, but wait a minute, 10,500 BCE, that's from the last ice age, and there was water every place, and it shows erosion all around it from great rains and water. So this was built before then. Oh, snap. Well, wait a minute. When is the next age of Leo? The next age of Leo is a whole procession of the cycle
which is 26,000 years. So the next cycle is 36,000 BCE. If you go to the Temple of Seti, the Osirian temple is right next to him. Inside of the Temple of Seti, Seti has a list of all the Nusubiti from the time of Narmer on one side, and then on the other side, which they don't show you, it has all the Netcheru. It has three sets of rulers. It has the divine Netcheru rulers, who were human beings in their right consciousness, who were operating like gods. Mm-hmm. And you have that ability. That's what happens to you when you're in your right mind. They're going to talk about, oh man, there was a group of gods that emerged from America in the 21st century. Okay? That would be y'all. Okay? So the ancient Kemetu talk about they had ancestors that walked on this earth who were godlike, Netcheru-like. They were defying principles and laws because they were the laws. They were the principles. And we were just imitating them. They got a whole list of them. Then they got the Shimsu Heru, the followers of Heru before Narmer. They got a whole row of them. And then he talks about his immediate ancestors, and that comes up to approximately 36,000 years. That's in the Temple of Seti. So if they say 36,000 years, and Heru and Maketi goes back almost 36,000 years. Are y'all starting to see the picture?
Oh yeah.
Take another sniff. We're gonna get ready to calm down. Okay, we're gonna move down. We're gonna start the one. I'm trying to show y'all that you are magical, Kemet. And the reason why Africans in America, more so than any other Africans on the continent or in the diaspora, are tapped into this magical information is because that's who you are. At the Library of Congress, they know who you are. If you go to Washington, D.C., you will see these faces all around the Library of Congress. But if you go to the east side, you see five faces, all African, saying that civilization began with the African melanated person. It's right there in Washington, D.C. And then they come all the way around, and last on the scale is the blue-eyed blonde, who's the most recessive and the last of the human family. He's actually an adoptee of the human family, stepchild. Okay, all right? They put it right in front of you. And on the doors right there, they get consciousness starts with Djibouti. That's in Washington, D.C. They got Djibouti right on the door. Then after that, they got Confucius and a whole lot of other people like that, but they start out with the lip and the tongue and the consciousness of the Netcheru. And so the people who built this country, who brought some of your ancestors here, understood this information. And they have become great using it.
Yeah.
How many of you have been to the, in Washington, to the temple of the York Temple and the Scottish Rite Temple? All inside of it is the Netcheru. They got Heru right up there. Every place you look is Heru. They got the falcons, they got the gems, the crystals. They got all of these things that are vibrating from ancient Kemet, not from Europe. And these are Europeans. They are vibrating off of our energy. Their sacred ceremonies and all their rites are stuff that they're getting out of the Perm Heru, the pyramid text, the coffin text. They are taking that information because you see, energy is not good or bad. Energy just is. You have the ability to do anything you want with it once you got it. That's why a martial artist, you know, in ancient times, you would have a martial artist who became this great master, right? And then he got tired of being broke, right? And just went out and started taking stuff. And nobody couldn't stop him. Oh, get back. Take some of that. Okay? And nobody couldn't do nothing about it. And y'all were saying, oh man, he's evil. Someone sent a good guy after him. No, the good guy got destroyed too. Yeah. Okay? Because the only way evil can destroy good is evil. Good has to prepare itself for evil. And they meet in battle. You ain't gonna win just because you're good. You go to church every Sunday, and the other guy out cutting folks all during the week and robbing people all week, right? And then y'all meet on Saturday. What do you think gonna happen? You get ready to get cut and beat up and get robbed. Okay, all right? You got to prepare yourself. Good and evil. I won a national champion at Madison Square Garden a couple decades ago. I'm fighting this guy, Rodriguez. He's red, white, and blue outfit, cover of Karate Illustrated, and he's doing Van Damme splits and all of this, you know. So we get to the finals. So I go in my corner, and I meditate. Now my son is my biggest fan. He said, Dad, you gotta start warming up. This guy's bad. You know? I said, son, I got this. No, Dad, you're gonna need more than Amun. This guy kid, he was like throwing kicks, you know, all up to the ceiling, you know. He said, Dad, you gotta break a sweat. I said, no, son, you don't understand this. When I go out there, it's not gonna be Infundishi. I'm going out with the Netaru. I'm going out with Shungo, Haru, Batama. I got all of them with me. I got Shaka Zulu. I got all of them with me. That's who I'm bringing with me.